The Faraway Horses by Buck Brannaman with William Reynolds. Narrated by John Pruden. Copyright 2001 by Buck Brannaman with William Reynolds. This unabridged audiobook was published by arrangement with the Lions Press, an imprint of Globe Pequot Press, and was produced in the year 2011 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright there too. Foreword. My life relationships with horses started after childhood, but I had wanted a pony as far back as I can remember. As a child of the 1950s and of a father who was a pioneer in television, I was never unaware of the impact of the TV Western in my life. It fed my need for horse flesh at an addictive rate. This ultimately alarmed my parents. We were urban-bound and landlocked on three sides, so to slip a pony into the backyard would have been quite impossible without the fabric of the neighborhood coming apart at the seams. Of course, I knew and actually understood the problem, but I refused to let the pressure off my parents. They tried valiantly with riding lessons and trips to dude ranches during school vacations, but it was never enough. My first horse, unlike the Will James book of the same name, arrived during my early 20s. She was a young liver chestnut quarter horse mare with a flaxen mane and tail, and was, if in my eyes alone, perfect. I should have sensed some trouble when it took us 3 hours to load her into a neighbor's trailer. It required all sorts of ropes and pulleys with lots of yelling and screaming, but we got her in. My adventure had begun. I met Buck Brannaman in 1985. He was at a local arena in Malibu, California, and to see a Montana cowboy work with a bunch of hunter-jumper riders was a sight I didn't want to miss. I had heard a little about Buck from my friend Chaz Weldon, the legendary saddlemaker in Billings, Montana. Chaz spoke quite highly of him and said he was designed to ride horses. When I first saw Buck, I knew Chaz was right. Buck is three-quarters leg, the kind of rider who can touch his heels under the belly of a horse at a lope. I later found out that he was rather short going through high school but grew a full 6 inches in his senior year, which landed him on the basketball team. Is he tall? The man could hunt geese with a rake. The first time you see Buck ride is a moment of lasting impression. It isn't just the way he sits a horse, although that in itself is rather impressive. As he rides, he seems to disappear into the action. People speak of becoming one with something. Buck doesn't ride a horse, he merges with it. The essence of this merger is a friendly takeover. I've seen him ride hundreds of different horses, and it happens every time. There is a moment when these two beings open doors to each other and communication happens. He creates an environment, unique to each horse he rides, that enables the two of them to work together. It still astounds me every time I see him ride a new colt. Each one is different, each is unique, and that's how he treats them. If this sounds like a good way to be with people, you're catching on. Buck has done more good for families as well as their horses than any man I know. He does this by getting people to slow down and listen. Listen to their horses, their kids, their husbands, and their wives. He is about respecting others, whether they are people or horses. They're all the same to him. The Faraway Horses opens a door into the life of Buck Brannaman. He has chosen to open it and let us all in. In his own words, he takes you through his difficult childhood and his youth growing up in a foster home. It is the story of a life of discovery, of pain and tragedy, and of finding one's way and then giving back to the ones who saved him. For Buck, it was horses. The horses saved his life. These stories make up a significant young man's life, a young man who changes for the better the lives of every horse and rider he comes in contact with. I am proud to call him my friend and to have worked on this book. Quite simply, we need a lot more like him. Bill Reynolds, Santa Ynez, California, 2001. Introduction. The stories in this book are scenes from the private movie of my life. They have helped me understand the big picture, and they have influenced directions I've taken since the events happened. In many ways, they have affected the way I work with certain horses. I know they have influenced me in the way I deal with people, but horses have always meant a certain level of consistency in my life. They respond with all their being. All they know is honesty. On my way to a horsemanship clinic I was putting on in Ellensburg, Washington, I decided to make a little detour through Coeur d'Alene, Idaho. It's a peaceful town, and its beauty is magnetic. I can see why so many people have come here to retire. I sat looking out my truck window, with my horses standing quietly in my trailer, at the old house at 3219 North 4th Street. That's where my older brother Smokey and I lived with our mom and dad for a few years in the mid-1960s. Seeing it more than 30 years later brought back a flood of memories. The shed, not much more than an overhang to the back of the house, made me think of milking cows there, and how, in the eyes of a kid just 4 feet tall, that pitiful little shed seemed like a huge barn. When I saw the basement window, I remembered struggling to drag a hose through it so I could water our horses, cows, and pigs, and how more often than not that hose would hang up at the hose joint just a few feet short of the stock tank. The yard was where Smokey and I learned to ride and spin a rope, little knowing we would soon be performing on TV and at rodeos and fairs around the country as the Idaho Cowboys, Buckshot and Smokey from Coeur d'Alene, Idaho. The number on that beat-up old mailbox stared back at me. 3219. I was tempted to knock on the door to see who lives there and maybe walk around a little. So many memories. So many times the ambulance would arrive at the house to collect my mom because she was having a diabetic reaction. And so many times our neighbors would call the sheriff because old man Brannaman was working his kids over again. But today, I'm no longer afraid, not even of the memories. In a strange, almost melancholic way, it felt good to be here. Who would have thought that one of those Idaho cowboys would grow up and have the joy of working with so many people and their horses, trying to help create relationships based on trust? It's ironic. Trust was something I had in short supply as a youngster. Ride with me now, and I'll tell you some of what's happened along the way. It's been kind of bumpy, but well worth the trip. Things are so good for me now, due in large part to my wife Mary. It is to her, to my family, and to the horse that I dedicate not only this book, but my life. Thank you for your interest, and may your life be filled with good horses. Buck Brannaman, Sheridan, Wyoming, 2001. 1. Growing Pains. I'm about halfway through a year's worth of giving horse clinics around the country. I love what I do, but I'm away from my family for long stretches at a time, and that's tough. My wife, Mary, stays at our ranch with our three daughters, doing all the things a working ranch demands. Leaving them is hard. My youngest daughter still asks, "Why, Daddy, do you have to go and ride the Faraway horses?" So, off I go for 3 to 4 days at each stop, meeting people and their horses, helping them get along and get things done together. Then I leave. I'm always starting, but I'm always leaving. When the expressions of the horses and the people start to become more pleasing to the eye, I have to say so long. It's hard to explain how other people's horses could save your life, but that's exactly what happened to me. I've been thinking about this quite a bit lately. Today, my horses and I rolled into a clinic in North Carolina. It's a fall day and the sun is just up. It's just past that time in the early morning when you can close your eyes, turn around and pinpoint the first fingers of the rising sun. I love that time. Everything starts fresh from that point on. The day, the horses, and the people. It's a quiet time as well. I talk all day for a living, so I do appreciate quiet. I get to feed and saddle horses in the quiet. The only sounds are those of the horses as they eat. There is a wonderfully predictable sameness to this scene, yet there is a newness that seems to permeate each first day of a clinic. I can feel the possibilities. It's a reassuring constant. The idea of constancy is something that I've valued ever since I was little, because it wasn't there much then. I was born in 1962 in Sheboygan, Wisconsin, but I grew up in Idaho and Montana. My family lived in California for a little while, but by the time I was 2 years old, we were living in the house on North 4th Street in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho. Given all that happened when I was little, the geography probably saved me as much as the horses did. The populations of Idaho and Montana are about the same as many small cities in this country, so you can imagine how small some of the towns in these states can be. Those stories you hear about towns being only a bar and a post office are true in many cases. My dad, Ace Brannaman, was a talented man who had many jobs. He was a union cable splicer, and he worked on construction crews building steel towers carrying power lines from the hydroelectric dams that were being constructed across the West and up in Alaska. He had a saddle and boot repair shop, and he was a private security cop for a while. Then he worked in a sheriff's department as a deputy, which is kind of ironic when you look back at some of the things he did later on in his life. My mom, Carol Alberta Brannaman, worked for General Telephone and Electric in Idaho, then as a waitress when we moved to Montana. I went through a bunch as a little guy, and I can tell you there were times when I wondered if my brother and I would make it. I can remember looking up at the sky and, however simplistic it may seem now, wondering if there was a God up there. I'm sure at times we all ponder whether or not there's a God. I find myself asking big questions when I'm driving or riding alone on horseback, and I'm here to tell you that there is a God. If you don't want to call him that, call him or her what you want. I was thinking about this quite a few years ago when Mom was still alive. She had diabetes, and it was real serious then. Medical science didn't have much luck controlling diabetes in those days, and even though she gave herself insulin shots, she'd been in and out of the hospital a number of times. Dad was working in Alaska, and my older brother Smokey and I were at home in Coeur d'Alene with her. I was 5 years old, the same age as my daughter Riata is now. Late one night, Smokey and I heard something that woke us up. My mother was having a diabetic reaction, going through the stage of delirium that typically precedes a coma unless treatment is given right away. We ran into the bedroom terrified. Mom was having a hard time. Smokey was only 7, and as he was trying to settle her, he hollered for me to run into the living room and call an ambulance. I raced into the living room, but the phone was up on a railing, and I couldn't reach it. As I was scrambling up a chair back, the phone rang. I still couldn't reach it, so I grabbed a towel from the stove in the kitchen and snapped the receiver down from its perch. Scared that my mom was going to die, I yelled into the receiver, "I don't know who you are, but my mom's going to die if you don't help me. We need an ambulance because my mom's a diabetic." And then I stood up on the chair and hung it up. The call had come from an old gentleman named Mr. Thompson. The Thompsons were probably the only black family in Coeur d'Alene in those days. Mr. Thompson had come to build a life for his family by running a dairy herd on the backside of Lake Coeur d'Alene. My dad had about 7 years of vet school when he was a young man, and when he was home from a construction job, he ran sort of a black market veterinary service. He'd pull calves and doctor cattle and sew up horses for people. Mr. Thompson had called to have a calf pulled. When I told Mr. Thompson to call the ambulance and then hung up, I had no idea who I was speaking to. Of course, he called the ambulance and sent it to our house, and within just a few minutes it arrived. The paramedics took my mother to the hospital, and Smokey and I were taken to the neighbors and stayed the night. After a few days of worry, my mom was home, and everything was fine again. It was uncanny how the phone happened to ring just as I'd gotten to it. If I picked it up a second sooner, Mr. Thompson's call would have been cut off. Timing is everything. Timing was always a part of my young life. Timing and practicing. My entire youth was spent practicing. Not the piano or tennis, but rope tricks. As a young man, my dad admired the famous trick roper Monty Montana, and he became infatuated with Montana's life. After returning from World War II, he realized he would never be a Monty Montana, but he decided that his boys would be. He would live vicariously through Smokey and me. Dad figured Buckshot and Smokey would sell better than Dan and Bill, so I became Buckshot and Bill became Smokey. Dad pushed us real hard. My brother and I would practice for hours each day. We had the choice of practicing rope tricks or getting whipped. After just a few whippings, we sorted out pretty quick that practicing our rope tricks was the wise choice to make. The reward was to travel around the country and perform. We all went as a family, and Mom would hover over us, making sure life went on as normally as possible. Although I enjoyed the audience's applause and attention, there were days when we'd have given anything to go out and play baseball. We did a bit, but most days consisted of getting on a horse and practicing roping. I learned to ride when I was 3, about the same time I started practicing rope tricks. Dad got Smokey and me some gentle horses, put us on, and away we went, taking easy rides around the yard. My dad could ride a little bit, but he just didn't seem to have talent for working with horses. I wouldn't say that he was abusive, at least not all the time, but he didn't have feelings or compassion for horses. He was of the old school, like a lot of people were then, and looking back, I just don't think he knew a hell of a lot about horses. His folks were farmers. He had been raised on a farm in Indiana, so he never really learned much about working with horses. Our first performance as trick ropers was 2 years later on a Spokane, Washington TV talent show called The Starlit Stairway. It was on Channel 6 and was sponsored by Boyle Heating Oil. A couple of little girls sang the jingle for Boyle Heating Oil, and I thought they were the most beautiful girls I'd ever seen. Granted, I was only 5 or 6 years old, but I guess I must have had an eye for the ladies even then. I thought they were big stars because I'd see them every week on TV. The talent was mostly local kids, tap dancing, singing, or playing musical instruments. During the auditions, there was a girl ahead of us tap dancing. She had her long blonde hair all done up in curlers, and as she was dancing this little routine, the curler started falling out of her hair almost in time with the music. I was just a little guy, and I thought that was the neatest thing. I couldn't imagine how they had done those curlers up so they could fall out in perfect time like that, and how she didn't run out of curlers until the dance was over. The girl was so embarrassed she started crying. I wondered why in the world she would be crying after such a nice performance. When Smokey and I did our rope tricks, I had to stand on a box. I was a bit of a runt in those days, so my dad made a cube out of plywood and painted it white, and I stood on top of it. If I didn't, I was so short my rope would hit the ground when I spun it. We did rope tricks like wedding rings, the merry-go-round, ocean waves, and Texas skips. During the commercial break, the judges were talking about who they were going to award first place. Our family was kind of huddled together, and I remember hearing the judges say, "Let's give it to those Idaho cowboys from Coeur d'Alene." And they did. They awarded us first prize for the talent show that night. I don't remember what the prize was, but the name the Idaho Cowboys stuck. From then on, we were billed as the Idaho Cowboys, Buckshot and Smokey. By the time I was 6 or 7, Smokey and I joined the Rodeo Cowboys Association, now called the Professional Rodeo Cowboys Association, PRCA, and had started performing at local rodeos around the country. Most of these shows were little pumpkin rollers that didn't amount to much, but they were a big deal to us. My dad changed jobs quite a bit during this period, but most of the time he was working for himself in his saddle and boot repair shop. He worked around our roping career so he could haul us to rodeos. The money that we made all went into his pocket, so the trick roping was kind of his job too, or so he looked at it. Our mom was quite a seamstress. She'd buy material and make us flashy outfits like the singing cowboys used to wear on stage and in the movies. I still have some of them. Other than a couple of pictures and some really nice memories, they're all I've got left of her. I wish I could have known her as an adult. In 1969, Smokey and I performed at our first indoor rodeo, a big one called the Diamond Spur Rodeo in Spokane, Washington. We had done trick roping at quite a few amateur rodeos, and we were getting to where we were fairly well known in northern Idaho and eastern Washington, but we were just starting our professional careers elsewhere. It was a Thursday, the opening night of the rodeo. I looked into the Coliseum from the back gate and saw 8,000 people in the grandstands. It was the biggest crowd I had ever seen, and I was very nervous. There were horses of every color moving in and out. It seemed like chaos at the time, but everyone knew where they were going. For a little kid who had barely been outside the Idaho Panhandle, it was an amazing spectacle. The rodeo clowns were getting their jalopy car act prepared near one gate, while the barrel racers were blasting up and back along one of the handling chutes. Then the announcer started giving his introductions for the evening performance, and through all the confusion I heard, "Ladies and gentlemen, the Idaho Cowboys." The plan was that Smokey and I would gallop into the arena on our pintos, make a full circle, do a sliding stop in the center, and then stand up on our horses and begin spinning ropes. When we made our grand entry, I had no time to be scared. Smokey took off first. He tipped his hat and made his circle, and I was right behind him. I got about a quarter of the way around when my mare, Ladybird, decided she was going to save us a lot of time. Evidently, she thought making a full lap was pointless. She cut hard to her left and took me right out toward the center of the arena. I was pulling as hard as a 7-year-old could pull. My brother looked across the arena at me, wondering what in the world I was doing, while I looked right back at him, wondering what I was going to do. About the time I got to the center of the arena, Ladybird slammed on the brakes and ejected me over her head. The world seemed to disappear as I did a complete somersault in the middle of the arena, then darned if I didn't land on my feet. And not only did I land on my feet, but I still had my rope in my hands. I stood there completely bewildered, amazed that I wasn't dead. I looked up at a now dead silent crowd for about 2 seconds, and then began spinning my rope. My legs were shaking like Elvis doing blue suede shoes. The crowd went nuts. Little did they know I had fallen in you know what and had come out smelling like a rose. Smokey couldn't believe it. I'm sure that seeing me fly through the air, he felt he was going to be the sole heir to the vast Brannaman family fortune of 9 milk cows with pitifully small udders. Every night from then on, the crowd would whisper in anticipation of this brilliant gymnast trick roper who was only 7 years old and could jump off a galloping horse at 35 miles an hour, do a flip in the air, land on his feet, and do rope tricks. I never did that little trick again. It's funny how once in a while little things can really go wrong, yet they work out right in spite of you. I've done a lot of things in my life that have worked out in spite of me, but I'll never forget the Diamond Spur Rodeo and how one of the best performances of my life was an accident. Smokey and I had chores to do at home, including milking a handful of cows every morning and night. We had a milking machine, which sounds as if it would have made the work easier, but it was a 2-boy job carrying all that milk to the house a tub at a time. Afterward, we had to run all the milk through an old-fashioned cream separator. The separator had about 200 parts, and we had to sterilize each one of them every single time we ran milk through it. That was quite a job because we milked those cows every day and night. Maybe that's why I don't drink milk anymore. I figure it might give relief to some poor little kid not to have to produce milk for me. In the evenings, after we finished milking, we'd practice our rope tricks. Smokey was a better roper than I was in those days. He could do the Texas skip better than I could because he was taller and it was easier for him to jump through a vertical loop. But he didn't like to practice quite as much as I did, so when we were little guys, if he wasn't playing the games I wanted to play, I threatened to go practice my rope tricks. And if he wasn't practicing when I was, well, That was a good way to get a whipping from Dad for not putting out enough effort. That's the secret of how I could pretty much get Smokey to play whatever I wanted to. We had a little round black Angus bull we used to breed a bunch of milk cows with. Samson was his name. He liked to hang around us, and he became pretty friendly. When my paint mare Ladybird, the horse I did rope tricks off of, became pregnant and I couldn't ride her, I got Samson broke to ride. I had a heck of a time keeping the saddle on him. The bovine mouth isn't exactly designed for a snaffle bit, and Samson kept rubbing the headstall off. Still, everything worked out fine. I trained Samson so he'd bow down to let me climb on and off, which became important because I was small in stature and Samson kept growing. I'd take him up in the mountains, and even after Ladybird had her foal, I kept riding him. I'd been riding Samson for nearly a year and a half when my dad butchered him. Dad didn't even warn me. It was as though he saw no need to talk to me about whether killing my pet was okay in my mind. It just happened. And what's more, he made my brother and me help. Of course, it affected me, but with my father, you knew better than to show you were upset. To have shown any emotion would have upset my dad, and he would have taken it out on me. So my dad made us help butcher my friend, and I ate Samson too because I didn't want to suffer the consequences of not eating him. Lots of things happen to little kids, but that's the sort of thing you never forget. By the time I was 8, we had moved from Coeur d'Alene to Whitehall, Montana. Dad rented a Quonset hut with a brick front on Main Street and opened a saddle and repair shop. My mom worked in a restaurant about 50 miles away in a little town called Ennis. Smokey and I walked home from school for lunch every day. After we ate, Mom would take us back to school on her way to work. This meant in the afternoons we'd be coming home from school to spend a few hours with Dad, without Mom around, after he got home from the repair shop. When she dropped us off at school, I'd tell her how scared I was to be home alone with Dad. I was afraid of doing something wrong, afraid of getting whipped. Smokey was a little tougher and had a thicker hide, but I was Mom's baby. I'd beg her not to leave me, and every day she'd cry. I never really considered how hard that was on her, but I knew how hard it was on me. I was terrified. I hated for lunchtime to come. It seems funny that a little boy would be afraid of lunch coming, but that's what lunchtime signified to me every day, 5 days a week. I was afraid to go home. I was terrified of my dad. For no reason Smokey and I could figure out, he was always angry. Whatever the reason, Dad was an angry man. There were days when he would come home and just beat us. He'd whip us with belts or riding quirts or anything handy, but always when Mom was gone. She would never have allowed it if she'd been around. She was our protector, but we were afraid to tell her. My folks did really love each other. Dad always drank some, but he wasn't a real problem drinker while Mom was alive. He'd always had kind of a mean side to him, and it didn't take drinking for it to come out. It was pretty much out all the time. We didn't know the way he treated us was called abuse because we'd never known anything else. It wasn't life-threatening, at least not until after Mom died, but it was damn sure cruel. Nowadays, Dad would have gotten in trouble with the law for what he was doing, but back then law enforcement didn't have much to do with domestic problems. Besides, most people didn't know what was going on. If I saw someone now treating his young boys the way Dad treated us, I think I might have to work him over. When I was a kid, I always wondered why my mom didn't leave and take us boys with her. But in those days, it wasn't acceptable to leave a marriage. She wasn't raised that way. Her parents were German immigrants who wouldn't have thought very much of her if she hadn't been able to tolerate even a bad marriage. It was a different time, and they would have blamed her, not Dad. I know she hated for lunchtime to come too, because she'd always have to say goodbye, and by the time she finished cleaning up the restaurant and got home, it would be late at night. Some days things were okay with Dad. He didn't give us a hard time, but there were a lot of days when he'd holler at us and we'd get whipped. It's not that Mom didn't know. I suppose she always knew what kind of man Dad was. There's something that kicks in when a mother sees her children being abused. Maternal instinct takes over and she can fight like a lion. But Mom was in a bad spot. Strong as she was, she felt trapped. She had no way to make enough money to support three of us, nowhere to go, and she was a long way from her family. I'm sure she could have given 100 reasons why she stayed married. Maybe some of it was denial. Maybe she just didn't want to believe that she'd made such a bad choice. There are a lot of things about my mom's past that made her what she was, things I'll never know. And if she were still alive, there are a lot of questions I would love to ask her. There was an afternoon that we came home from school when Mom was at work and Dad was moving around, walking around the place, going in and out of the barn. I knew he was mad. It was only about 100 yards from the county road to the house, and I wished we could take all night to get there. When he saw us, he immediately started hollering and swearing. One of us had left a gate open when we were doing chores in the morning. You know young boys, you know how forgetful they can be. They don't mean to do anything wrong. A lot of times they just forget, or something makes their brains turn off. Anyhow, we'd left a gate open. Nothing really had gone wrong. One of our horses got into a pen with another horse, but they were geldings and they got along fine. It was really no big deal, just a matter of catching the horse and putting him back in his own pen. But Dad was so angry that we had forgotten to close the gate that he went into the barn and came out with his stock whip. The whip was 8 feet long. I knew what was coming, and my little legs were just shaking. He'd told us to put our books down on the front steps. We were on the east side of the house in the backyard near Mom's clothesline. I was wearing a short-sleeved shirt and a pair of lightweight pants. I remember looking at those clothes on the clothesline and wishing I had them all on at the same time to protect me from what was about to happen. Dad made us go over to a rail fence that ran around the house. He told us to hang on to one of the rails and stand there. And then he started whipping us with that stock whip. Once in a while, the lash would wrap around my arm up by the shoulder, and it'd crack just like a .22 rifle. It hurt as if I'd been shot, too. There were even places where it cut through my shirt. Granted, it probably wasn't much of a shirt, but still, whipping a kid hard enough to cut his shirt meant you were hitting him pretty hard. Dad was whipping us over our backs and down our legs when I saw a neighbor looking out of his ranch house at us. He didn't know what to do, but I remember looking at him and wishing he was man enough to come over and stop what was happening. My dad was still hollering, cussing, and whipping us when the phone rang. He told us to stay where we were and ran into the house to answer it. When he came back, his mood had changed. The phone call was from someone who wanted Smokey and me to do a TV commercial for Kellogg's Sugar Pops. Dad was excited now. This was another chance for him to vicariously share the spotlight with us. He went from whipping us to being as happy as could be. At the time, we didn't give a damn about a TV commercial, but we sure were glad the phone rang when it did. I've often thought it was by the grace of God that the phone rang that day and cut our whipping short. We'd have gotten it a lot worse than we did. We went ahead and made the Sugar Pops commercial. The funny thing was, they shot it in a town called Grace, Idaho. You know, there are so many little coincidences in life that make you wonder how God or your guardian angel or whoever it is protecting you can keep it all straight. You start putting all those pieces together years later, and it's kind of surreal. When I was 11 and we were living in Whitehall, Mom had a bad bout of the flu. She'd been in bed for 2 or 3 days and Dad was trying to take care of her. When he gave her some soup, it never occurred to us that the soup would change her blood sugar level. During the night, she went into a diabetic coma, although nobody knew it. The next morning, Dad was worried. He came in, woke us up and said, "We have to take your mother to the hospital in Ennis." Mom was a big lady, all of 6 feet tall, and it took all three of us to get her into the truck. She was in terrible distress, and she couldn't control her bladder. Dad and Smokey held her upper body to help her into the truck. I grabbed her legs and carefully lifted them in. Urine ran down over my hands. That really scared me. I knew Mom was bad. I knew it was awfully serious. Dad left us at home, took off with Mom for the hospital, and we went on to school. We worried about our mother all day and night, but Dad never called. Mom was in the hospital for 3 long days, and during that entire time, we never heard from him. Finally, on the morning of the 4th day, Dad came home. He just came into the house and stood before us and said, "Boys, your mother's gone." That was it. I was shocked. Mom had been in and out of the hospital so many times with her diabetes that I figured she'd come home and we'd go on. But she didn't, and we had to. For Mom, trick roping had meant more than anything. It was the glue that held our family together. When Smokey and I did the Sugar Pops commercial, she loved it. The spot ran nationally, and we were dubbed the Sugar Pops Kids. Mom's only moment in the limelight had been as a dance instructor at an Arthur Murray dance studio when she was a young woman, and she was elated that we were on national television. She would sit in front of the TV and pray that the commercial would come on. After Mom passed away, one of her nurses who went to the funeral told me that while she had been in a coma the entire time she was in the hospital, they had left a TV playing in her room. I guess they thought the constant voices and sounds would help stimulate her back to consciousness. Just before she died, our Sugar Pops commercial came on and Smokey and I were doing our rope tricks. As soon as the commercial was over, Mom passed away. I can't help but think that she heard our voices, and maybe that was all she needed. Maybe hearing her babies one last time was her way of saying goodbye. I guess we all have our way of saying I love you and goodbye. Timing again. It just keeps showing up. With Mom gone, Dad changed for the worse. He had always been pretty rough on us, and it had gotten to the point where he'd been turned into the law quite a few times, but he never did anything life-threatening while Mom was alive. The moment he told us she was gone, I knew life was going to get tougher. Within a year of Mom's death, Dad had pretty much fallen apart. He really loved Mom, and losing his wife seemed to drive him over the brink. He drank heavily, and he just didn't want to live anymore. He'd had a rough life. He'd been a prisoner of war in Germany for over a year during World War II. God knows what they did to him. He never told us. But maybe he never got over the experience. To make matters worse, Dad had a near-fatal accident in Alaska, receiving a big jolt of electricity while working as a lineman. He was in the hospital for 6 or 8 months. After he came home, he suffered from horrible headaches. They seemed to torture him for the rest of his life. For whatever reason, he justified his anguish by blaming Smokey and me. Maybe he thought that if we weren't around, Mom would still be alive. Not our mom, mind you, his wife. During that time, Smokey and I would talk as we walked to the bus stop for school, pondering whether or not we were going to live through the next night, let alone the school year. We lived in fear every day. We felt we had no safe place, and we're heading down a road with no good ending in sight. Dad was drinking so much he couldn't sleep, and got to where he would keep us awake many nights, running, hollering, and screaming at us, beating us, and slapping us around. Our dining room table was solid oak and surrounded by oak captain's chairs. I stared at that wood grain a lot when he made us sit there and take his yelling. By the time he was thoroughly liquored up, it would be late. The wood stove in the corner would have long gone out, and the house would have turned cold. Dad would get us out of bed, and we'd have to sit there in our underwear, shaking from the cold and knowing what was ahead of us. He'd never notice our discomfort or fear because he was so full of his own antifreeze. One night, Dad pulled us out of bed about midnight. He'd been on a drinking binge since shortly after dinner. We had to sit down at the table while he yelled at us for a couple of hours. It must have been 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, and we begged him to let us go back to bed. But no, he walked from the table to the refrigerator, reached in the freezer, and pulled out one of his trusty bottles of vodka. He'd drink some of that, and then he'd drink a beer. It was his ritual. On his return from the kitchen, he'd ask us, "What are you little bastards looking at?" That was the tip-off. Another butt-whipping party was about to start, and we were the guests of honor. Dad had a riding crop with a molded plastic handle that he'd use on us. I'm sure that's the reason why, even today, I'm still a little touchy about riding crops. We were too afraid to run because Dad always told us we'd get it worse if we did. But this night, he was really drunk, and we couldn't face it. We'd had enough. We were tired of going to school bruised and beaten with no sleep. So we took off running. The house was perfect for a chase. It had a sort of island in the middle, and a full circle would take you from the kitchen, through the bathroom, into the living room and dining room, and back again. We ran through the kitchen. I was in the lead with Smokey right behind me. Dad was on the other side of the house trying to catch up. Suddenly, Smokey stopped, opened the drawer where the cutlery was kept, and pulled out a steak knife. The desperate look in his eyes scared me, but I understood. Smokey just didn't want another beating. He was finally going to take care of us. I knew that if Dad saw him with that knife...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.